It's 4 o'clock in Radio Cairo. This is World of Info. We're coming live from Studio 3. My name is Dr. Amr MABROUK. Da'a Muhammad is at the control. And it's a beautiful day, beautiful hot day in Cairo. Thursday, and we are approaching Eid al-Adha, and I think we can always say to you happy feast and enjoy the feast, enjoy the vacation that will start officially on Monday. But a lot of people that I know are started their vacation already, and they are heading directly to the north coast or to the east coast. I don't know where they are heading to, but I'm here working and working for another 3 days in a row until next Monday. But today is the World of Info, and to keep your company on the road if you are strangled in anywhere in Cairo or in Egypt, we are coming live from Studio 3, and here we are with the World of Info, having 3 books to tell you and talk to you about. Time for summer is summer readings, and by summer reading you have more time on the beach or on the sea, or even you have more time, even if you are staying in hot Cairo behind, to read more. And the famous saying is that you read to lead. And yes, we are here to read and to give you information about some of the books that have been recently on the bestsellers of Cairo top charts. And today we are going to give you the rule of the game. The rule of the game is, should we read it, skim it, or toss it? And the July reading included up till now 3 beautiful books, and one of them is an old one, but let's talk about the 2 new ones which deserve to be given some notes and information about, stimulating you to read them. And if you are not an Arabic language reader, maybe you should wait for the translation, or you should listen to my program where I'm going to tell you some details about these 2 beautiful books. The first book is by Ambassador Muhammad Tawfiq, Hams al-Aqrab, or The Scorpion Whisper. And the second book is by Professor Muhammad Afifi, the famous professor of history, and he is the head, the ex-head of the Department of History in Faculty of Arts, Cairo University, and he was the president of the Supreme Council of Culture, a man with a lot of work and titles he had, but this time, for the first time in his life, he's going to write a novel to us, and the novel is by the name of Yaqub. And of course, since he is a historian and a very eminent one, and of course the professor of modern history in Cairo University, definitely the novel or the story that we're going to hear about or read about is a historical book or historical story or a novel. And the book, the third book of today, is a book to supplement the book of Dr. Muhammad Afifi, and actually an introduction was written by him. It's called General Yaqub and the Knight Lascaris and the Independence Project of 1801 by Dr. Shafiq Ghurbal, the famous Professor Shafiq Ghurbal, the famous professor and the founder of the history schools all over Egypt. And he was the first professor of history in the Faculty of Arts in Cairo University, a very distinguished gentleman that we are going to talk about, because his shadows on the writing of the book of Professor Afifi, Yaqub, deserves to be mentioned. So, after the break, let's start and hit the road of music and hit also the road of books. Stay tuned with us in the World of Info, coming live from Radio Cairo. So, we're still listening to World of Info. Today is the World of Books, and we're coming live from Studio 3. Our direct line number is 2578-9407. If you'd like to call us, we are here listening and waiting for you. So, the first book. Well, it's a novel written by a very distinguished gentleman. And by this, I mean Ambassador, His Excellency Ambassador Muhammad Tawfiq, who finished his brilliant career in the Foreign Service, the Egyptian Foreign Service, as the Ambassador of Egypt to Washington, D.C. He was ambassador also to Lebanon and ambassador to Australia, and he has held a lot of posts all over the Foreign Service, all with great distinction and distinguished practice and service. And of course, we have to give a mention that in the beginning, he was a graduate of the Faculty of Engineering. And so he really can be able to be a very pragmatic gentleman and a man who can calculate every step he does before he moves. But when we read his books, and of course we had the pleasure and honor of having His Excellency Ambassador Muhammad Tawfiq here in our program to talk about one day in the life of Abdul Tawab due to a very beautiful novel that he has written in the 90s and has given sort of, we can say, an autobiography but semi-biography or a story or a novel of a lot of characters mixed and matched, and he put them all in some of the characters that has been has taken part of this beautiful novel. And here he comes with a historical novel. And I called Ambassador Muhammad Tawfiq, and unfortunately he's in summer, he's a summer vacation, but he promised that he's going to come to our program hopefully by mid-September or early October, where we are going to share with him his experience with this beautiful novel. But I thought that I should present this to the listeners who would be very much interested to have a summer reading. And usually a summer reading, as I said before, is a reading where you can at ease go into the pages of a book, not much, very much exhaust your mind and keep yourself a distance away from your surroundings, and at the same time keeping yourself away from the main characters, so you are just an observer. Well, I hate to disappoint you. This is not a classical summer reading. It's a good reading. That anything that it has in common with the summer reading is that the easiness that you are going to find yourself turning the pages of this mammoth novel that has occupied almost 370 pages, and yet you can easily read this with the beautiful prose of Ambassador Muhammad Tawfiq. The gentleman Muhammad Tawfiq has a very huge cultural background. He speaks, of course, very fluent Arabic and English, and I think he speaks more than that, maybe French as well, but we'll have to ask him about that as well. But his Arabic is perfect, and therefore his knowledge of poetry, of old turas and old heritage of Arabic literature and Arabic poetry, and at the same time he, in a personal phone call I did with him 2 days ago, he is very fond of Ibn Khaldun, and when he has written and chosen some of the beautiful verses that Ibn Khaldun has written about Egypt, and one of them is a very important sentence that goes around one of the main characters of the novel, as he was asked, "How do you find Cairo?" And his response was amazing, and this was this main response was the response of no one but Ibn Khaldun when he was asked, "How do you see Cairo?" And he said in a beautiful prose that Cairo for him is different than any other place in the world, and it's like a dream. And dreams are things or imagination that can really are not on the type of life or on the daily life, you see. But when you talk about Cairo, it exceeds the dreams. And this verse in particular was very mesmerizing, and it attracted my attention, and I asked him, was this the sentence that was made by Hussein Basha or Hussein Bey, the main character in the real life? And he said no, it was written, and it was written by the one and only Ibn Khaldun in one of his beautiful verses, which says, "What a man sees in his sleep is exceeding always reality. But the dream, whatever it is beautiful, cannot exceed and cannot reach the reality of Cairo." Such a beautiful verse, and more of these beautiful verses as you read in the book will attract your attention, because the prose will always make you easily go through the lines rapidly. But let's talk about the story. It's a historical novel, and yet Ambassador Mohammed Tawfiq is getting himself away from that it is a true story. He said he was definitely influenced by a very important, influential historical character, charismatic character that lived in the early 20th century and died in a car accident in 1946. And by this I mean Ahmed Basha Hassani, a very distinguished man indeed. A man who has carried the culture of Al-Azhar, because his father was one of the important sheikhs and scientists in Al-Azhar, who has brought up his son in a very distinguished way and even sent him to study in Oxford University. So it's a great mixture. A man who has a background, a strong background in Arabic and in religion, is suddenly taken out of this highly conservative environment and put where? In Oxford University, where he receives a degree, and at the same time, a great sportsman who has shared and taken a share in the Olympics, one of the first Olympics in 1912 in Stockholm, where he was playing fencing in Stockholm, representing the Egyptian team. And at the same time, Ahmed Basha Hassanin was working for, after he came from Oxford with a degree, he started working in different posts, and one of them was working in the secretary of the British High Commissioner, or the ambassador of Britain. And of course, Egypt at that time was ruled from the British Embassy. And so another mesmerizing situation. And then Ahmed Basha Hassanin meant the character Rose, who is a lady. Definitely she's working with definitely the British intelligence or whatever. She's claiming that she is a great explorer, and she wanted to explore the Western Desert, particularly the Libyan Desert, and trying to find the lost oasis. So this is the story, and this is the background of the story, and how Ahmed Basha Hassanin took Rose and went into an expedition in a convoy led by him and her, where she was represented as the wife of him. And they went on in the conquering the unknown, reaching El Kafra Oasis, which was not very well known to a lot of people at that time, and went to explore and other oasis nearby El Kafra, and went back with a lot of incidents and accidents. And in the true story, when Rose came back to her country, she has written a book and taken a lot of trophies, claiming that she was the leader of the convoy, and the convoy was hers, and that she and that Hassanin Basha was simply one of her subordinates. At that time, he was a simple gentleman. He was a bey, but he was still young. So this is the story. And later on, Hassanin Basha's credit was acknowledged by the British National Royal National Geographic Society, and he was given a decoration, and it was stated after he has written his book that he was the main commander or the main leader of this convoy, and the role of Rose was not that important. And rumors has it, especially what's written in the book of Muhammad al-Tabi, that Ahmed Basha Hassanin told him that he was very angry with what she has written in his book, in her book, describing him as a simple subordinate, and that he met her after he been acknowledged and given a trophy from the National Geographic, from the Royal Geographic Society. And she told him that, "I see that you're decorated, and what, if I may ask, what were you decorated for?" And he said, with a beautiful slap of prose, saying, "I was decorated for my chastity," claiming that he, during this period, although everybody thought that she was his wife, was completely having no physical relation with her. So this is the story, this is the myth, this is what was written by Muhammad al-Tabi about Ahmed Basha Hassanin, and everybody respected this story and took it for granted. So Muhammad Tawfiq, or Ambassador Muhammad Tawfiq, is not judging this story, he's not criticizing it, and he is just telling us that he has read both books, the book of Ahmad Basha Hassanin about this expedition and the book of Rose. And he say that Rose in her book was not that very much harsh to Ahmad Basha Hassanin, and she claimed that through his wisdom and his courage he was able to save the convoy many times. And Ahmad Basha Hassanin was clear, sharp cut in claiming that she was not a subordinate, but she was a companion, not the main leader and the thinker behind the work of the convoy. So what attracted Ambassador Muhammad Tawfiq in writing this book was simply not the story, although it's a very romantic story. A man meets a woman and he doesn't have any contact with her. He respects her, he might admire her, he might love her, but he keeps himself away, distance from her. And when Muhammad Tabi asked him why he did so, he said, because I was very afraid that if there anything wrong that I would do, we could get lost or wasted in the desert as a punishment from God. Well, Ahmad Basha Hassanin after that had a very colorful career. He became, after leaving the British embassy, he became one of the workers in the royal house or the royal palace with King Fuad, and King Fuad started admiring him, giving him the rank of a bey, and later on took him as a sort of a protector and a teacher and a lieutenant of his prince of Upper Egypt, Ahmad, King Farouk, or then later on known as King Farouk, when he traveled to take his education in Britain. And there were two lieutenants governing Farouk. These were Aziz Bashar Masri, the famous Egyptian general, and of course Ahmad Basha Hassanin. And then he became the chamberlain during the reign of King Farouk, helped him to keep his throne in 1942 in the famous incidents of the 4th of February 1942, and had a relation with his mother, Queen Nazli, which was well known, and it is documented that he was married to her, although the official papers were never found, or maybe they were kept or destroyed by the king after his premature death of Ahmad Basha Hassanin in a car accident that has a lot of question marks on Qasr al-Nil bridge in 1946. So this is the true story of Ahmad Basha Hassanin. So it's very attractive, but Muhammad Tawfiq took it from there and started invading the characters and started to analyze the background of the lady and the man. As he has written in the preface, this is not the story of Ahmad Basha Hassanin, this is not the story of Rose, but it's simply the story of a man and a woman who were having a lot of heritage and history and a lot of scars of their own lives, their own fears and their own ambitions and their own hopes. All of this is mixed in one simple place, the desert. The desert with all its mystique, with all its fears and all its hopes and all its solitude and all its romance. Both of them are in the middle of nowhere. Going where? Going to nowhere until they find the oasis and not get lost and losing the water and the food. It's a very tough expedition, and so Ambassador Tawfiq was trying to talk about the psychology and the psyche and the life and the minds of these two complicated characters. A lady who has lost a lot of her family, almost all her family members in World War I, either, and then her parents were lost to death and to depression after the loss of their son, and she lost her fiancé as well, and she's feeling as if she's escaping from somewhere and someplace just to find herself and to find a reason for her existence. while Ahmed Basha Hassanin or Hussein, because he is not the real Ahmed Basha Hassanin, is somebody who's got his education in Oxford, got his education in Al-Azhar, having a very mixed heritage and having two minds in one brain, and at the same time strong, ambitious character, and looking through the future with hopes and aspirations. And we can say, how can you're going to fill the 371 pages with just the mind talking between these two characters and their own selves? Well, we'll find other characters that they will meet in Al-Kafra Oasis, between the mayor of the Oasis, the representative of the Ottoman Empire, the ladies, the beautiful ladies, young ladies who were ladies, daughters of a very distinguished man in the Oasis, who has ancestorship goes back to the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. So all these characters that mix and match with something that is always common in between all these characters, that they are in the desert and in an oasis. And oasis is simply a salvage point in the middle of the desert. It has a beautiful lost haven where everybody is living in peace, that is going to be very soon disturbed by this expedition, by the exploration, and by the knowledge that they will spread to the world. And therefore Kafra is going to be involved in the attacks that will happen by the Italians to break the resistance of Omar Mukhtar and his colleagues, and at the same time in World War II it will be the subject of occupation and destruction, and as a sort of an important station of transport that goes in and out the hands of the Axis and the Allies. But still, this is not important. What's important is the mixed feelings that these characters have, how they are human beings and having emotions, how their backgrounds affect their behaviors, and how when they meet the man and the woman in 1938, almost 20 years after their last encounter, how are they going to behave, and what is in the background of Queen Nazbi herself? Well, it's a very interesting story. It's a very interesting novel, and I believe that the use of the imagination helped very much to change a convoy of expedition from going into facts of exploration and the lines and the vertical lines and the transverse lines and horizontal lines into something that is so vivid, full of life, full of solitude, and full of dreams that might or might not come true. The knots of the story or of the novel are not released by the end of the novel. We know what happened to Ahmed Basha Hassanin. We know through the lines what Rose has done in the last 20 years. But how will they remember each other, and how they are going to feel towards each other? This is something that we cannot really tell from between the lines. But we talk with gratitude to a novel that we simply could start as a simple summer reading, and we find ourselves drowning in the emotions and the bright and intelligent mind of Ambassador Muhammad Tawfiq. Thank you very much for a beautiful novel that he has written and released 2 weeks ago. So this is our first book of this beautiful afternoon in Cairo, which I highly recommend you, dear listeners, to read. Stay tuned with us to the World of Info after the break. So we're still listening to the World of Info, and today is World of Books. My name is Dr. Amr Mabrouk, and today we're presenting books. And the first book was The Whisper of the Scorpion by Muhammad Tawfiq, Ambassador Muhammad Tawfiq. And the second and the third book together are bonded together. And this is Yaqub by Professor Muhammad Afifi, the head of the history department in Cairo, the ex-head of the history department in Cairo University and the professor of modern history. And the book that is totally attached to the first one or the second one is General Yaqub and the Knight Lascaris, the project of Egypt independence in 1801 by Professor Shafiq Korbal, with an introduction and preface written by the same gentleman, Professor Muhammad Afifi, about Yaqub. Well, this is interesting. First of all, I had a discussion yesterday with Professor Muhammad Afifi on the phone. Unfortunately, he's giving his apologies for our listeners not able to come to our program, but he promised that he would come soon. And we talked about the book Yaqub by him, which is written as a sort of a novel. What makes this book so special is that it's written by a professor of history and a professor of modern history who is really a great reference about the period of the 19th, the 20th century, and even the 18th and the 17th. And it's his first trial as a writer of a novel, and he was very successful. And he made a mixture of the talk or of the prose of this beautiful novel. It's a short one about a biography, and then with the biography he's going through the world of imagination, and of course because of his training and education it has to have solid historical background. So we're talking of a very controversial character in the history of modern Egypt, and this is the man by the name of Yaqub. Yaqub was an Egyptian Copt. And we know from as far as the Islamic conquest or Islamic opening of Egypt that the Copts were very much respected, and they had proper education, especially in their kutab, where they had their kutab where they read the Bible and get an education, but also they have a training in mathematics. So a lot of Copts worked with in the ministry of what we can call Bayt al-Mal at that time, or the Ministry of Finance, and they were responsible for calculating and collecting the taxes for different periods or different dynasties that ruled Egypt, whether these were the original Khalifs or the Abbasid or the Amoid or the Mamluks or the Ayyubids. And even during the Ottoman time, all these the brilliant Copts had a job as sort of clerks with different grades, whether this is in the countryside or in big cities or even in Cairo, where they were responsible for finance. So no wonder that Yaqub started his career. He was a very intelligent young man, and he started his career in the finance as well, and working as an assistant and a clerk, and later on an eminent clerk with one of the Mamluks, one of the famous and prince Mamluks at that time. As the invasion of Egypt by the French and the defeat of the Mamluks, the French started using the same governmental issues of trying to control as well the finance of Egypt, and so they turned to the Copts or the clerks that were working with the Mamluks and started conscripting them to work with them as well. Yaqub was a different character. Yaqub was a very well-known clerk with a very great experience in finance and collecting taxes, and so he found his way with the French at that period of time. He had his own personal problems, is that he was married to a beautiful cousin of his, but unfortunately she died, and her and his only son died as well. He has received a great blow to his beliefs and faith with this death of his wife and his only child that has broken his faith, and therefore he was not a religious Copt. he even after reaching a higher status with the French started having extra marital affairs or getting more women in his life, whether these were young slaves or whatever he can get hold of. And of course this was received very negatively from the church and from the Pope himself. Then he went and got married to a Syrian lady from a different group of Christians, that is the Catholic and not Orthodox as he was. And of course this was received with great dismay from the Pope and from the religious hierarchy, and therefore he was prohibited from going to the church, and he even penetrated the church using his power and went inside the church with his horse and a sword. And this is completely different than the attitude of the Copts at that time for a man who's having this status and learning how to ride a horse and become a horseman, a knight. This was definitely a strange character. And he was able to convince the French that to use him not just as a clerk but as a warrior himself. And he promised that he's going to conscript some of the finest young Copts to join this small battalion. And the French admired him, especially General Désiré. And there is a rumor about the relation between him and General Désiré. And he was given the rank of a general in the French army. So we know that the French stayed from 1798 till 1801, and their stay in Egypt was short-lived. We know that the British has drowned or sank their fleet in Abu Qir, and therefore the French were being under siege in Egypt. Napoleon wanted to leave as early as he has come, doing his job in Egypt, and tried to go back and to save his ambitions and his dreams of reaching power in France. He left Kleber as the supreme commander, who was killed, assassinated by Suleiman al-Halabi, and later on Mino, or the general who turned to a Muslim by the name of Abdullah Mino, marrying Zubaydah, became the general or the commander who left Egypt under a certain agreement that was made between the French, the British and the Ottomans to leave Egypt. So this is a very complicated story. So where is Yaqub standing in the middle? Yaqub was involved. He formed this militia. He acted with complete loyalty to the French. He received great insults, and he was denied access to the Egyptian church. He was accused of being a traitor, and the Egyptians hated him, whether these were Copts or Muslims. So the moment that the French started their withdrawal from Egypt, one of the points of the agreement was that all the people who were collaborated with the French are given a sort of parole d'honneur not to be injured, and they are pardoned from any criminal accusations later on. So all the members of this militia or of this Copt battalion decided that they're going to stay in Egypt. And the famous Girgis Guhari, who was a famous clerk as well, decided and worked with the French, decided to stay, and nobody harmed him. He tried to convince Yaqub to stay, but Yaqub insisted on traveling with his daughter and his newly wedded wife and with some of the members of his family to France. Then comes the story, the most important point of the story was General Lascaris, or the Knight Lascaris. Who's Lascaris? He is Knight of Saint John from Malta, and he has a strong imagination. His character is full of flaws. He thought of himself as a magnificent, intelligent man, a dreamy man. who joined the French and started to try to convince them to stay in Egypt. He was a great support and a great fan of Yaqub, and he tried to convince the French to stay and to make Egypt a colony of them. And then when he left Egypt with the French and with Yaqub, he tried on board of British navy boats. The ships decided to go to the British captain and offer him to convey a message that this small degradable part of the Egyptians, this one I'm speaking about Yaqub and his the people who followed them, that they are representing the Egyptian people, and that they should be given a sort of promise to build a new Egypt. And he's offering the support of himself and of Yaqub to the British to invade Egypt and form a country that will take or fill the vacuum of Egypt left by the Ottomans and the French, and that this will also give credibility to the Egyptians and a sort of isolated independence under the supervision of the British. Of course, this is totally insane to consider that Yaqub and his colleagues were simply representing the Egyptians, while they were even removed from the Egyptian church and being held with great scorn from both religions. So the story goes that Yaqub, 2 days after boarding the ship, suffered from severe extreme illness. A lot of people think that he was poisoned, and he lost his life. And his colleagues asked the captain to leave his body in rum barrel in order to bury him in France when they reach France, instead of burying him in the sea. And Lascaris went to France, tried to make a similar offer to the French, where he was received with great dismay and disgust. So later on, Lascaris went back to Egypt after Muhammad Ali, rising to the helm of power, and tried to convince him to help him with the building of new and modern Egypt, and acting as a lieutenant to his son Ismail. The period that he stayed with Ismail was a very fishy period, and Ismail the son, not Ismail the son of Ibrahim Basha. So Ismail, the one who lost his life in Sudan in 1822. So in 1817, Lascaris was simply killed or being poisoned and died in a mysterious death, simply because he tried to cross the borders and trying to control Ismail Basha, and then by this he will control Muhammad Ali himself. So in one of the conspiracy theories, that he lost his life as regard of poisoning in 1817. So this is the talk about Yaqub and Lascaris. So where does the novel stays? Well, Dr. Muhammad Afifi started to give us a glimpse of the story of a history, of a history or a historian or a history professor, how he wants, and he was attracted after reading the book of Shafi Ghurbal to the character of Yaqub, and that he wanted to study him in depth, though he lacked all the possible sources. So we find that the main character of the novel Muhammad Afifi is either himself or the writer, who is by chance the history professor. And he gives us a glimpse how history or historians suffer to get information, how they get themselves into archives like the archives of Cairo or the archives of Paris, and gets down with great patience and persistence and perseverance to reach information and knowledge, to understand and to find a way to get information. And when we're talking about a controversial character, that is of Yaqub, the information is very small. So simply, beside telling us the story of Yaqub, Muhammad Afifi takes us through the main character of the novel between the archives of the Egyptian church and of Cairo and the archives of Paris to reach more information about Yaqub. So after the break we'll talk about the journey of the historian to find the truth about Yaqub. So the book starts with Muhammad Afifi, or the author, or the writer, or the historian, trying to get more information about this controversial character, Yaqub. And as he meets his distinguished professor, who is considering him to be like his godfather, and of course, after talking with Professor Afifi, it is well known that this famous professor is Professor Rauf Abbas, one of the great historians of Egypt and the former head of the history department in Cairo University, a man with great talent and great unbiased way of looking to history, and definitely a very great scientist indeed. So he approached Professor Rauf and told him, I want to make a thesis about the Copts and about even Yaqub. And he said, this is a very controversial character. Let's not talk about Yaqub in particular, but let's go into the Coptic history and find yourself a point to discuss. And through his premature life in Shubra, premature before maturity, when he was a child, he was raised in Shubra, which is a good mixing pot for Muslims and Christians, where his father had a very great neighbor who was a Copt, who helped him not only to reach the church itself, but to reach the Pope himself, Pope Shenouda, where he met him, discussed with him, and he accepted that he, even though he's a Muslim, but he's a scholar, should be entitled to read into the history books and the history archives, historical archives of the Coptic Church. And Pope Shenouda was very proud to be a graduate of the Faculty of Arts into the history section or history department, and this gives him a great attribute as a great nationalist and a great historian himself. So the story gets us, although while he was studying his points of his thesis, working with his different points of research, always Yaqub would pop out in his work. At the same time as he goes to the Cairo archives, or to go to the Egyptian Orthodox Church archives, or going to France, always Yaqub would pop in. And the story, and pulling the knitting of the stories and the knots together to draw a painting of Yaqub, that is definitely of great interest. So the novel is talking about the historian in his way to understand and to solve all the secrets and to find the information behind the lines, in between the lines, about Yaqub. And during his walk through the streets of France, or walking through the archives of Paris, he would meet a beautiful Lebanese lady by the name of Amnea. And they have a short friendship and a love affair that doesn't last very long, because Amnea was coming out of the civil war of Lebanon, where she has lost faith in the Middle East and decided that after she finishes her PhD, she would go and emigrate to Canada or United States. She said, I don't want to go back to the Middle East. So the glimpse of the story, the failed love of the professor, or of the researcher, or of the student, as he called himself, keeps him going to and fro into Yaqub, and even meeting people who were trying to prove that they were descendants of Yaqub. And in conclusion, he tells us the secret of Yaqub lies in that he was a revolutionary man. A man who had not much of great admiration or admirers. And although in the history and in the world of in the eyes of the Egyptians, whether they were Muslims or Christians, Yaqub was considered to be a traitor. Gabarty called him as a traitor, and the French took with him as a sort of a burned card, or a card that has lost its importance, and therefore after his death they never were concerned to write a full history of him. The French, as all the conquerors, would always admire the people who defend their country, and they would not be interested to give a line or two in their history books about the people who dealt with them or betrayed their country and their life. However, we should always say that every coin has two sides, and some people would consider Yaqub as a pragmatic character, as a revolutionary man who wanted independence of Egypt. And by this we mean the extreme of the extremes. And there were two extremes at this period of time. Some of the rebellious, strong current of rebellious young Copts who would say that he was a great revolutionary man. And of course, this is a very low, small minority, especially that the church has dismembered him from the church and prohibited him from going to the church. And of course, the work that was written by the father or the godfather of Egyptian history, and by this I mean Shafiq Qurbal, because Shafiq Qurbal was a very pragmatic person, a gentleman who studied liberally under the Professor Twimby in the UK, and therefore he had a liberal way of thinking. And so he, as a liberal, would say that maybe Yaqub was a nationalist and wanted an independence, or putting words that Yaqub has never said to actions that were made by him, and saying that he wanted to have an independence of Egypt, which I don't think that Yaqub, with his background, ever mentioned. Maybe Lascaris was the one who put these words on the tongues of Yaqub. So there is a lot of misinformation about Yaqub, but the conclusion is simply that he was a man that was looked upon by great skepticism by both the Muslims and the Christians of Egypt. But remains the work of the novel. When we talk about the novelist, or about the student, or about the researcher in history, we'll understand how difficult it is to work as a historian, how difficult it is to find amid of huge pages that were neglected and kept in the archives, whether these were in the church or in the Cairo archives or in the French archives, to join all these dots to form a picture and a story of a man that simply died almost 220 years ago. So, a very beautiful work written by Professor Muhammad Afifi about how a professor of history or a historian would chase the dream of getting more information about the character. And we see history inside a novel. And today we presented the story of, or the novel of, Yaqub by Muhammad Afifi, Professor Muhammad Afifi, and the supporting book of the story, General Yaqub and the Knight Lascaris, and the project of independence of Egypt in 1801 by Shafiq Qurbal. And in the first half of the program, we presented the novel by Ambassador Muhammad Tawfiq, The Whisper of the Scorpion. May I wish you a very pleasant vacation and happy Eid, and hope you'll enjoy as much as I did enjoy the summer reading. And maybe I'll come back, hopefully, inshallah, soon, with more books that I've read to share with you in the world of info. My name is Dr. Amr Mabrouk. Dua Muhammad was at the control. Stay tuned to Radio Cairo, and see you next week, hopefully.